Then you might not be present physically, but in every sense you are present, you are following, and these incredible ideas are going to be helpful to us. I was taking note as people kept sharing. Stephen from Vermont talked about human rights. The very alarming situation that we have in Uganda. On a daily basis, we hear of people that have been abducted, some very close to us, some might not be close to us, but we get to hear someone has been picked up somewhere. Those that you get to know, it's because they are a bit popular and well-known, but the situation is a problematic one. Why? Because you have a regime that has decided it will keep in power against all odds. So when people speak out, when people oppose, then they'll be picked up and treated the way they are treated. I was telling colleagues in Parliament recently that in a sinking boat, no one is safe. Whenever we talk about these situations in Parliament, some of our colleagues on the other side, they mock us. A few weeks ago, a member of Parliament of all the NRMs was abducted. Shortly after court had granted him bail, within the precincts of court, can you imagine? Reminded me of the Black Mamba situation many years ago. This guy was abducted, the same style all our people are abducted. Gunwilly men in ordinary clothes. And for 3 to 4 days, his family did not know where he was, lawyers. And I saw family members who were looking for the speaker or whoever to petition and say, where is that person? I empathize with that family. And then I reminded the NRM colleagues, and you see what is happening here. This is what we go through every single day. And I don't care what this man did. Take him through the rightful legal channels. So that's the situation that is happening. And I'm glad that people are following. Mukisa talked about the land elections. In Uganda, our land size is 241,000 square kilometers. That's the size of California. So the 241,000 square kilometers do not grow, do not enlarge. But the population does on a daily basis. Right now, we are told we are about 45.9 million, that's 46 million. In 5 years, it will be higher. That means pressure on the land keeps growing by the day. And so one of the biggest time bombs we have in Uganda is the land question. The population keeps growing, the land does not. And so families are tearing each other apart. You read the stories. People are sitting in each other's throats. The mighty and powerful are pouncing on the vulnerable to take away the only thing they have. For most people in Uganda, the only major thing they have is land. And so they are being pounced upon, and this land is being grabbed. It happens every passing day. Richard Meyer from California talked about our economy, which has shrunk and continues to shrink. You know why I hear Mr. Museveni, the set of the National Address, talking about all these glowing, flowery figures, which reminds us about our GDP in 1986 and what it is today. And I'm like, but this man is not serious. You see, if you, how many of you know Masaka? Many of you. When you leave Kampala and you go to Masaka, on average, maybe about 2 hours, on average, you know, if you take care of traffic and so on, on average about 2 hours. Now, if you set off from City Square, you guys know where City Square is, eh? If you set off from City Square and 5 hours later you are in Busega, now actually move, tell me, you made it to Masaka. There's progress, no doubt. 10 hours later, you're in Chengira. There's progress. You're here in Masaka. But 10 hours later, this is a 2 hour journey. Now, that's what the Museveni is still talking to us about. You see, our economy has grown when you compare it to 1986. Of course, it has grown. But at what rate? Is this where we should be? And she's excited about those figures. And you see the number of tarmac kilometer roads back then were this, and now it is this. And I just do not understand this field. Of course, yes, there has been progress. But what kind of progress? 40 years later, are we where we are supposed to be, where we should be? So that's the massacre situation. A 2 hour journey, 10 hours later, you're not even halfway. But you're excited, you made progress. That's what this Jesus are always excited about. Dr. Mutiaba from Minnesota talked about education reforms. Nelson Mandela said that education is the most powerful weapon you can use to transform the world. And that is true. But you see, it also matters the quality of education. Dr. Ssenyonyi here, who is now a teacher, he ran away from what he used to do as an affinder. Now he has mastered teaching. It is not just any kind of education. It ought to be quality education, which we do not have in Uganda. The other thing they are always excited about is, you see, UPE has enabled many young people to go to school. That's true, but I normally call it quantity education, as opposed to quality education. So they are excited about the number of children who are in school. So many. Oh yes, they are in school, but what kind of education are they getting? This is a civil society organization, and some of you talk about CSOs, that did call voice of did research on these UPE schools. Children in P6, majority of them were failing work for P2, P1. But they're in P6. And these people are happy that children have enrolled in the school. What kind of education are they attending there? There's something called capitation grant. This is a money that facilitates their education. Now, this might alarm you for those who don't know. Each child in UPE is allocated about 20,000 Uganda shillings. How many dollars are those? And by the way, that's not every term. That's every year. 20,000, about 20,000 shillings. This is money meant to facilitate their education, application grant. About maybe $6. What kind of education can you get in $6 a year? You tell me, just think about it. Just think about it. No wonder children in business cannot do P1 work. We must change that. And you see some of these things, not of desires. Invest in that education. Invest in the teachers. Our teachers back home are running away from the teaching profession. Why? Because it's not making sense anymore. They have been told now sciences are more important than the arts. So you're having science teachers earning about 3 times what the arts teachers are earning. They sit in the same staff room, they teach the same man hours. But everyone is being told, no, you science teachers are more important than the arts teachers. But how? How many of you here in this room are scientists? Don't fear. Okay, so the rest of you are artists, right? Eh? So are you guys are using the supporting seven? Who by the way did arts himself? And we know how he performed. So it's a problem. Which you must change. Let me tell you. You and I are going to play, and I'm glad we are playing our role, our part, in bettering our country. But there is what there is a place which I saw, and our children and grandchildren will take over. But they will not do a good job if they have got a quantity education as opposed to quality education. That generation, I worry when I see that generation. So we must fix that. Dr. Karim, did I call you Dr.? In the DMV area, talked about advocacy and international relations. I want to appreciate you diaspora people. There is work that you do which is so incredible, I'm sure sometimes you don't notice. The sanctions that we see for these things of ours back in Uganda, these goods, this is the work you do. So never think that you do that work in vain. I think some of you are excited about what we are doing. You say, I'm doing a pretty good job down there. And nobody says, you're doing a pretty good work too here.
Yeah.
You say, how much hour is not comparable to what you guys do on the ground. It doesn't matter that you're not there. The work you do here, it makes a whole lot of a difference. Please keep doing it. The Boston team talked to us about women empowerment. I read a quote, I don't know by who, that the human race is like a two-winged bird. One wing representing the males, and then the females, the other wing. If only one wing is developed, that bird will not fly. That's the reality. You think about a bird. Get that one wing, clip it off. The bird is not going to fly. And that's the situation we must fix. You know that women are as, not just important, but as necessary for country development and betterment. So we must pay attention to these issues. Mr. Pima from Seattle, UK. Talk to us. Talk to us about the role of CS Force. You see, civil society organizations, where they are serious, they move and shape things. Yes, they do. When Kenya was sending name runs away. Arab Moy, Daniel Arab Moy. Party. Everybody in that country played their part. The young people did, the professionals, and then the civil society. They said, this is our country. And they all went hard. And you see how civil society was taking over the game. Uganda is beginning to pick up. Yes, not one that the civil society is beginning to pick up. No wonder the regime is going hard on these CS Force. Slam even down. Somebody talked about those CS Force, many of them that are closed, because there is a part they play when they do play that part. That's important. We keep trying to engage them and helping them realize that we actually don't want them to support us as anything. We want them to support us because they are part of that country. Stuart emphasized the role of the youth. Uganda is the youngest nation. We swapping position 1 and 2 with Niger. The last I checked, we are now in the youngest. We are now in number 1 position. That's a resource which we must tap into. Some people think of it as a problem. Now that these young people must take care of them, must feed them, let's empower them. It's a huge resource that we must make good use of. Saidi emphasized healthcare. We have a real problem in Uganda. And I'm glad people are following, and you know, from your conversations. We have a huge healthcare problem. Well, among many other problems. But I look at healthcare and I'm like, what is this? Somebody talked about cancer. I don't know whether it was suicide. I lost somebody, a neighbor, last the other week to cancer. And I went to the Cancer Institute. The last time I was there was some other time again, my patient. You know, people sleep outside in the cold. Now, forget about people sleeping within the hospital, in the corridors, on the floor. On the outside, in the cold. And a number of these are actually patients. So some of them die sooner, not because the ailment has intensified. But this is a cancer patient, so a lady whose face was swollen and she was sleeping on the outside in the cold because there's just nowhere to sleep. I don't talk about these things. Some people think we are politicizing the situation, but it's a reality. I'm sure you have relatives whom you send money to go to a private health facility because the public one, there's no care there. There's nothing. This week, we have been battling with governments to deploy interns. Are you following that conversation back home?
Because the interns are saying, I've been training for 5, 6, some of them 7 years, or whatever the case might be. So they need 1 year to get their licenses. They want to be deployed. And that will be saying there's no money. And I said, you guys, you say there's no money. Are you telling this to yourself? How can that be an issue? Because we see the things money is spent on, and it doesn't make sense at all. These interns, they do the bulk of the work in our health centers. For those who, when we are back in Uganda, if you went to hospital at midnight or thereabouts, you will see the wards full of interns. And I want to do the real work. Because the specialists, that time, you know, they're going to sleep. They read their books, they are experienced. They're not going to be working like 3 a.m. But the interns are the ones doing that work. Now they're not there. And we expect somehow things will move. We must fix these things. And I'm glad we know where the problem is, at least from representations. Maggie emphasized youth unemployment that has led to pretty rain. Many young people who are in a state of disconsolateness find them in the Arab world. And they are stuck. Some of them are being duped. So they get there, their travel documents are taken away from them, and they are in sex slaves. It's a reality. Many of them return home in body bags because their organs have been plucked out and all manner of things. Why are they left home to go and make out a living? Because there's nothing happening for them back home. This is a situation that you and I have got to contend with. Hillary put up a very exquisite presentation. You see, this eco thing has not been getting as much attention as I think it should. Yesterday, there are about 45 young people that were arrested by police, because they were protesting about this eco. And one of the things Hillary emphasized, which is so true, is the many agreements that we enter into that are problematic. Number one, because of corruption, some of our officials who go to enter into those contracts, they are given a kickback, so they just sign. Others, it's just that they are so disconnected and confused. They don't even know what it is that they are seeking to do. When I was still here in Kosase, one of the investigations we did was on the expansion of the Internet Airport. Mr. Matia Saita, the finance minister, signed a loan agreement with China's Exim Bank, worth $200 million. I read that agreement, and then I read it again. The first time I thought, maybe this is something else, huh? So I read it again. And then I invited him to the committee. I said, Chief, did you sign this document? He said, yes. I said, did you read it? He said, yes. Now I said, let me take you through some problematic clauses I see in this loan agreement. One, we, in every sense, it's like we are mortgaging our airport. In every sense. Those are not the words you should bear. But when you read the detail of it, an account was to be created when this entity, Civil Aviation Authority, I just have one saying, some of these random conflict fellows, saying you guys didn't even produce a report. It's even on the parliament website. The report that we did detailing all the issues we pointed out. Of course, there are other reports to be like Uganda Airlines, which were thrown out the window by this corrupt woman. I don't care to call her corrupt, especially when the governor said that she's a corrupt woman. Yeah. There's nothing she's going to do to me. Nothing. She wishes there is something she could do to me. There is nothing. But let me make the point as well. Before I began to think about this very corrupt woman. In this loan agreement, the entity, Civil Aviation Authority, after it has made its budget, It's supposed to send it to China to approve.
Yeah.
In that agreement. Before they send any money, after the budget is approved, now, if China has spent money, China has to first approve. We're talking about a sovereign state. And all of these things are in the agreement. In plain English, you don't have to be, I don't know, lawyer or whatever to understand the agreement. It's in plain English. Again, one of the clauses is there, really. If there is a dispute regarding this agreement, there needs to be arbitration. Where? In China. If arbitration fails, you go to court. Where? In China. How do you sign such an agreement? And you are a minister on behalf of the country. And then you say you have the country. Either you're corrupt or you're so incompetent, you don't know what it is you mean. So then I asked him again, did you read this agreement? He told me, yes, but my technical people advised me that all was well. I said, chief, forget about the technical people. You must have them, of course, as a minister. But I said, you, this is your signature. Because now, some people were telling me, now let's go after the technical people. I said, I'm not going to go after the technical people. The man who signed the agreement is here. I said, you are educated at master's level. Is this kind of agreement okay? Of course, it turned out he had not read this thing properly. Hillary told you, Saida Bumba. She had a master's thinking, I don't know why. She signed things which she had no idea about. And that's the challenge for me. Of these contracts. Now, eventually, the African Union came and told us the commitment we are giving to the country, especially after that's the time we tabled the report. So, we were asking government over the things. So, he said, I commit on behalf of government, we are not going to default on this loan, we are not going to lose any of our properties. He said, but you see, the loan is already skewed. First of all, the interest rates were very high. And so, we have got to deal with this situation. We are going to pay that money, all the unfavorable clauses to deal with them. At our cost, at our children's cost. So that's the challenge, even with these agreements. When we were pressing hard about them, they said, but you see, you people, you know, these documents are very sensitive. When we give them to you people, you will leak them. And we're saying, so where are you getting approval? Because you're supposed to get that approval from Parliament. So if you say you cannot avail to us those documents because we shall leave them, what are you hiding? Yeah. One of my prayers is that this man leaves without touching that way. Because that which he is important. You see that now he is very incorrigible. He comes off as a ponderant figure, he thinks he's very powerful. If this man touches oil money, he's going to become a problem. Because now he's saying, my way. So then it will be my money. Which he will use to brutalize Uganda a lot more. And so it's my prayer, as we fight hard, as we do all that we can, because we shall end up with the oil cast that he was talking to us about. Look at Nigeria. As I remember, Nigeria, a few years ago, actually went ahead of South Africa and was the wealthiest nation in Africa. But you see, that wealth has always been in the hands of a few. So the economists use all these GDP per capita parameters to say that now, if in this room we are, let's say 1,000 people, as an example, one person earns $1 million, another $10 million, then there is one who earns nothing. So we shall get the total amount of money and divide it by all the people in this room. So even the one who earns nothing, eventually the figure will show this one also earns $1,000. But the fellow earns nothing. So that's the fallacy of GDP and GDP per capita parameters that we use. Because you tend to imagine that Everyone is okay. So that's the situation in Nigeria. So those very few, especially politically connected people, have stolen the whole money and they are filthy rich. But the vast majority of the population is so poor. The population in Nigeria is 229 million people. Most of those are poor. But it's a very rich country. Why? The oil cars. Because the leaders who are in charge are thieves, they care a lot about the people. So that money will be used for their self-aggrandizement. As I end, I know we're going to have time to talk about million things. As we shape ourselves into the alternative, I hope we keep reflecting on the fact that we must be a credible alternative. So with that, then we might become like the same. So we need to keep warning ourselves and cautioning ourselves, we must be the credible alternative. How many of you have read the book Sowing the Mustard Seed? You should read it. The 10-point program. Have you guys read that book? It's a very little book. You should read that book. It will excite you and then it will annoy you. I'm excited because incredible stuff that these guys are thinking about. But it will annoy you because they have failed on each of the 10 points, each one of them, without exception. But they knew what to do. You and I know what to do. Let's commit to doing that. Thank you.